GOP representative Andrew Clyde defended his description of rioters on January 6th. He had referred to them as tourists, but he's kind of walking that back a little bit now. So what am I talking about? Take a look at this interaction.
Statements that you made saying that the January 6th violent insurrection against Congress was akin to a normal tourist visit. And those officers said they weren't tourists, they were terrorists. Do you stand by your statement that they were tourists?
I would like you to quote my exact statement, not your interpretation of my statement.
Okay. Watching the TV footage of those who entered the Capitol and walked through Statuary Hall showed people in an orderly fashion staying between the stanchions and ropes, taking videos and pictures. You know, if you didn't know the TV footage was a video from January 6th, you would actually think it was a normal tourist visit. Those are your words.
And I stand by that exact statement as I said it.
So he was right.
So he lied, because clearly that is not what happened in the nation's capital on January 6th as hordes of Trump supporters stormed the Capitol and in some cases resorted to violence toward any Capitol police or DC metropolitan police who stood in their way. Mm-hmm. So
what I don't understand about it is, why did he just waste a minute of our time?
Right.
He said, I didn't say that, say what I said. He reads what he actually said, he's like, yeah, I said that. Okay, then just say that you said it. I'm glad that Raskin had the quote ready. That's always important. If you're gonna bring up someone's quote, definitely bring it, because they're all gonna pretend that they didn't see it, or they didn't hear it, or they didn't say it, or whatever. But let's be clear, it's good for the moment. It's good for, you know, bringing receipts or whatever. But it's not like, oh, and now that guy looks like an idiot and his followers will be forced to grapple with an inconvenient reality. They're not gonna do that, and he knows that they're not gonna do that, which is why he's not gonna back off from what he said. He can make up whatever lie he wants, because all of the traditional systems of accountability don't work, because in the best of times they're founded on the idea that if you are proven to be hypocritical or immoral or corrupt or a liar or whatever, that people will care, but people don't have any standards anymore. So why would you ever backtrack on one of your insane lies or statements?
Well, the thing that I just can't get past, and I'm stuck on this issue. What's supposed to happen when the violence that we experienced on that day is justified, minimized by an entire political party? Like, what are we to expect in the future, which is something that we should be concerned about, but also—
More violence.
More violence, exactly.
Yeah.
And so I don't even know, like, I don't know what we're supposed to do. I guess that's my only hang up on all of this, because sure, the select committee holding these hearings is fine. I do think that there's a component of it that's just purely political, right? Everything is political, let's keep it real. But it's honestly killing my soul to see right wingers justify what happened or deny what happened, minimize what happened. And empower these people. They're emboldening them, they're empowering them. And of course, one of the other tactics that I'm seeing is just deflections, right? Let's deflect, let's focus on Antifa, let's focus on Black Lives Matter, let's focus on anything other than the people who our party incited to carry out those actions on January 6th.
I think that's why we've been fighting against whataboutism for years.
It drives
it's a losing
me nuts.
Battle. Because look, if you're gonna have this growing movement that is against, like people call it, like they talk about the death of expertise or whatever, but it's a death of accountability, it's the death of truth. It is teaching people over the course of a lifespan, an entire generation plus, that you do not ever have to accept anything that makes you even mildly uncomfortable. Everything can be exactly what you want, and it doesn't matter what the doctors say, it doesn't matter what the teachers say, it doesn't matter what everybody says. If I tell you that it's the way you want it to be, then you can just come here, shelter under my wing. I will keep you warm and comfortable, and that's it. And people have been just trained in that way, it's been made worse via cable news and then the internet, which was supposed to be, you know, the source for people to have information, instead helped people form communities where they never had to be exposed to any inconvenient information. And there's so much incentive to lie, to feed people's worst impulses for money. There's so much grift everywhere you look on all sides of the political spectrum that, like, can we be surprised that people have failed? It's not like we were the best humans on the planet before all of this, and enough cracks have been worked into us and weeds have gotten in and they've spread and everything is falling apart because we don't have any sort of united front against all the lies, all the nonsense, the rejection of reality.
No, I mean, we live in a country under a system that incentivizes individualistic, you know, actions, specifically, hey, it's every man for himself. Where are the incentives? What can you do in your leadership, in your commentary, if you're in news, that's gonna draw the most attention, the most profit?
We see it that congressman.
We see it in the media, exactly. You see it with members of Congress. You see it with, even in the executive branch, there's no question, right? Like, profit over people, profit over country, profit over everything. You see it in the media, mm-hmm. where people will literally say things they don't even believe.
He knows yeah. You're a Taurus.
Yeah, I know.
But why accept that? Like, if you will just be replaced by someone who pretends they were Taurus. That's all it is. If he came out and said, you know, I've watched the video and it's really rough, then Trump's gonna tell his fans to support someone to primary him. He'll be knocked out because those people don't fundamentally care. There's no incentives to accept reality.
I know. And I don't know where we go from here because things have consistently gotten worse. During the Obama administration, a small group of officials in the Department of Homeland Security were tasked with investigating and keeping an eye on right-wing terrorism in the United States. Conservatives lost their minds over that,
yep.
and succeeded in getting Obama to disband that group within DHS. And here we are today, folks. Like, it's no surprise that we're experiencing what we're experiencing today. The government has turned a blind eye to right-wing extremism within our borders. At the same time, remember, like, look at the broader picture and the types of discussions that were taking place as, you know, these violent militia groups were feeling more and more empowered. You have right-wingers who are justifying the militia groups now, turning around and saying that Tamir Rice deserved to be shot within 2 seconds of the cop showing up at the mm-hmm. park. Yeah, he was playing with a toy gun, and maybe the cop should have asked a question or two before opening fire, but hey, that 12-year-old boy deserved to die.
Yeah.
Just put it all together and pay attention to the discourse coming from the right wing. Right wing terrorists in this country, totally fine, turn a blind eye to it.
Yeah.
12-year-old kid playing with a gun, a toy gun at a park, shoot and kill him within 2 seconds. Totally fine that a cop did that. I just take a good hard look at what the right wing is justifying in this country. And enough with the whataboutism. Okay, let's focus on the topic at hand. What happened in the nation's capital is unacceptable. I don't care if the insurrectionists didn't succeed in toppling the government.
Yep.
They intended to do that. Yes, they're disorganized idiots who failed to do that, but it doesn't take away from what the intention was and what the violence carried out looked like.
Yeah, and it's entirely possible that the attack itself isn't as horrifying when you zoom out as the takeaways. Because the fact that that could not get them to accept that there was a problem might be more damaging in the long term than the damage they were able to do pooping on the floor in the Congress and setting fires and beating cops and all of that. Like, coming out of it, right-wing media has demonstrated, no, we're totally fine with this. So one has to speculate what they would have had to have done to get Sean Hannity to have a problem with it, or Tucker Carlson to be a little bit worried about what it means. We don't know, I hope we never find out. And so sometimes people ask, like, why do you talk about some people? Like, why did we do a segment about Charlie Kirk before? Because these are the tools for radicalization.
Yep.
Like, the person who storms the Capitol is a major issue. But for every one of those, there's 500,000 or a million other conservatives that are perfectly willing to pop a bag of popcorn and watch the end of the democratic experiment in America. And they are being trained by politicians like we showed you in that video, and people like Charlie Kirk and Tucker Carlson and Newsmax and all that. That is how you take people and turn them into human monsters, willing to see chaos and death and suffering and all of that.
Thanks for watching The Young Turks, really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.